What's going on, everyone? My name is Nicholas Merton here at Data Dash, and today is December 13th of 2021. Well, folks, I hope you are having a fantastic day wherever you are, and in today's video, I want to spend some time to talk about a topic that many might see as an unfortunate reality or truth that we need to face when conducting cycle analysis for Bitcoin's price. And I got to be completely frank, I don't see many other people in the space talking about this. In fact, they generally take the opposite opinion of seeing it as a purely bullish event and that nothing could go wrong. And I want to spend some time to talk about the Bitcoin halving event, the event that happens every 4 years where Bitcoin's supply schedule or inflation rate drops in half, further reducing the issuance of new Bitcoin. And all the while, this has been the precursor and catalyst for practically every major bull market for Bitcoin in the past. I want to spend some time to talk about why it's not only had a decaying effect over time, but it is going to get minuscule here over the next couple halving cycles, and is going to have less and less of an effect on price, and therefore cannot be used as such a major means of understanding where Bitcoin's price is going to go next. We're going to be diving into this and more as we go throughout the video right after our quick sponsor. And our sponsor for today's episode is Emberfund. Emberfund's new Tap to Earn program is designed to help users learn about crypto daily. To incentivize learning, Ember awards its users with Satoshis for opening the app and viewing educational content each day. To start earning, users simply need to download the Emberfund app through the referral link down below and tap Start Earning on the Ember mining page every 24 hours. Users can double their earnings as well by inviting their friends or depositing funds in a portfolio. Use my referral link down below and start earning with me today on Emberfund. Alrighty, everyone, let's go ahead and dive into this topic. It is a big one at that, but let's go ahead and just start off with this tweet I recently put out just the last night. And it basically was a referencing towards a tweet from Bitcoin Magazine where they had mentioned that 90% of the 21 million Bitcoin that will ever exist has now already been mined. We've already seen the vast majority of Bitcoin supply already enter into the market. So now there's only 10% left to be mined here by all miners across the globe, no matter where they come from, what resources they put in, how much hash rate they put in, doesn't matter. No matter what, there will only be 10% more supply added on top of the existing supply. It's a little under 19 million, around 18.9 million at the moment. Now, that's over the next 119 years until 2140, when Bitcoin supply should absolutely reach its finite limit of 21 million coins. Now, overall, again, as we've talked about as far back as, you know, the start of this channel, we've talked about it back in the early days. We talked about it in 2019 when no one was talking about crypto markets, when we were in a deep bear market, how the halving event has been a catalyst for driving Bitcoin's price. I want to spend some time today to share a different perspective. What if it has lost its effect? And we can even see it throughout history starting to lose its effect to a point where this is no longer going to be the ultimate catalyst that drives a price. Whereas instead of having a supply shock that's going to drive future rallies, we're going to need more demand to drive up price rather than reductions in supply. Okay? So I just want to go ahead and pull up probably one of the most talked about data science models in the crypto space. And it is a controversial one at that, but one of which I think is actually a great data science model, even though I'm going to be providing some, not per se criticism, but some important talking points you need to consider. You generally find two people in the crypto space and when it comes to the stock to flow model, which we're going to be talking about, the S2F model. This is created by an individual known as Plan B, a really nice respected data science modelist in the crypto space. But I want to go ahead and talk about the two perspectives. You either find people on one end of the stick who say that the stock to flow is yet again another attempt at the crypto space to try to understand crypto markets when we really have no idea where things are going. They criticize the fact that it's a regressive analysis where we're constantly adding in new data points and always rerunning the model. But on the other end of the stick as well, people point to the fact that the stock to flow has considered a really important macro event, the Bitcoin halving event, and it's done a pretty decent job of being able to understand where the fair value of Bitcoin should be. And to be honest, I actually lean a little bit more on that camp. I think that it's one of many other great data science models we can utilize over time in order to get some understanding for where Bitcoin can go. But I do want to talk about something that is very important, that we should not take one data science model or one person at that, even including myself, as full truth in this space. And I think that's become an overwhelming reality here over the past couple of weeks as people's expectations for Bitcoin to reach 98K, 100, 120K, 200K by the year end have gotten completely squashed. and are highly unlikely at this point, as we've been rambling on about at this channel, right? So keeping that in mind, I want to go ahead and talk about why the halving event and how we can even view it in the stock flow model, how it has had a decaying effect over time. Let's take a look at how the cycle tops play within the halving model, right? And this, excuse me, the stock to flow model, my apologies. We can see here that with each cycle peak here, right? For example, December 2013, December 2017, right? Not only do we get basically a further, as we go back in history, right? And as we progress throughout time, right? We get lower divergences in the model variance from the fair value of the stock to flow from the cycle top. But along with this as well, these variances are happening later on from the flattening of fair value. As you can see here within the stock to flow, right? We get these periods where there's general growth here after the catalysm of the halving event, where things start to plateau out and it kind of masks the fair value according to the halving event or the basic reduction in issuance of new supply. We can see here that each and every time, whereas we in fact almost kind of saw precursors or rallies beforehand, they've now started to get later and later. And we're seeing that play out right here comparative to 2017, right? If we were to play it out exactly like 2017, or better yet, like 2014, we should have gone well beyond that and had our cycle peak, as a lot of people were expecting for, right? Because many people go solely off of the stock to flow model for their data science analysis. And to be completely frank with you guys, whether you're trading crypto markets or equity markets, doing that is a really bad move because your viewpoint can get incredibly siloed thinking that this is the ultimate thing that I just gotta watch out for. I'm gonna sell the cycle top, it's gonna be easy peasy. When in reality, sometimes, whether it's one or multiple data science models, you're going to find that history may not always rhyme or repeat, right? And the general point I wanna make here is that we need to understand and observe how these models not only change over time, but how price changes in the interaction with these models, right? How the variance here plays out over time. Because we can see here very clearly, this is the longest period of time since we've been able in any previous cycle to get above really the stock to flow line here, right? The general red line that is used as kind of a means to understand when Bitcoin's price is undersold, overbought, generally what the fair value of Bitcoin should be, which is a target range here of around $70,000 to $80,000, right? $78,000 to $80,000. Now, as we can see here within the model, it's taking longer and longer. And along with that, we've talked extensively here on the channel criticizing another major view of the market, which is the four-year cycle. And this goes heavily again off of the halving event. It goes off of the idea that you have the annualized bear market. It takes about a year. That's historically accurate for sure. But outside of that, the general consolidation and bull market phases, they're catalyzed by the halving event, right? The problem with that model that people always were touting is just clear confident that it was absolutely the way to analyze markets. The problem is, well, if you really want to go off of it right now, the four-year cycle has pretty much failed at this point if we don't reach 100K by the end of the year or 200K, this kind of cycle top number that people have been calling for, right? And outside of that, we've only had one cycle top to top, which is how the four-year cycle analyst works, which is from back here in November, December 2013 here towards December, January of 2018, right? That's the only other time we've seen an actual four-year cycle. If you wanted to include a four-year cycle back here, you'd have to include price information that doesn't exist, a period of time in which multiple months, by the way, where Bitcoin wasn't traded. We, on the other hand, have been utilizing something what is generally known as expanding cycles. And it takes in mind from bottom to top that each cycle has seen about an annualized increase in expansion. This one being a 13-month expansion, this one being a 11-month expansion. You can see that between the variable number in the bars here, right? You can see a 13-month expansion, 11-month expansion. And if we meet in the middle at 12 months for this cycle, we get a reasonable target of probably a heightened number like 100, 150K to 100K by November of 2022. When we take a look at the logarithmic chart, this looks absolutely reasonable. In fact, Bitcoin's price has been waning along this logarithmic line that's going straight through our general prediction for the entire cycle. It looks pretty healthy, looks reasonable for that matter, right? Now, why would it be that the cycles have to get longer. Some of you might be wondering, okay, Nick, I understand you like the expanding cycles. I understand the kind of critiques of the stock to flow model. Why is it that this would take longer each and every time? All right? Because generally speaking, it's not always true that cycles have to get longer in markets. It isn't always the case. Sometimes we have quicker bull markets. Sometimes we have shorter bear markets or longer bear markets. You know, there can be all types of different time frames that happen, and it depends very much on macro events. Well, the biggest reason here is because Bitcoin itself was very clearly defined as this finite asset. This finite asset that has a fixed supply schedule that reduces over time, right? The thing is, the halving event, which really played a big role in determining Bitcoin's price, has now started to get to a point where it's having little to no effect. Now, let's go ahead and visualize this here. And I want to kind of put things into context, okay? So this is Bitcoin's inflation rate comparative to price. Now we can see here, ironically enough, in a period of time where inflation was quite high here, that Bitcoin's price started to see really heightened price moves. Now, am I here to argue that a high inflation rate is good for the underlying value of the asset? No, I'm not here to argue that whatsoever. But what we saw during that period of time was an early stage market, whereas the growth factor was much greater because you're starting off much closer to zero, right? Practically no value at all, no market participants, no users, no buyers have entered and really into the market at this time, right? You had a much higher demand schedule as per supply on the market, all right? So you can see here, even on an annualized basis back here, and for example, say, we can scroll down here over time towards October 2010, you had annualized inflation rates anywhere from around 100 to 200%, as again, difficulty adjustment hadn't completely come through, and the inflation rate was quite high at the time for Bitcoin, right? You can see here that inflation rates were very, very high. Now, again, even though the inflation rates were practically at a rate where on an annualized basis, the supply was doubling, right? Where there's just maybe a couple million Bitcoin in the market, the fact of the matter is there was much greater demand back then, much greater demand in the market that could compensate that increase in supply. And that's why the inflation rate was quite high during the initial parts of the day in order to have some distributed means of distribution of supply. So not all one person would hold the supply. Then we had the first halving event here in late 2012, my apologies. Inflation rate dropped from around 28, give or take 30% down here towards a general inflation rate of around 12, 15%. It varies generally if you're looking at the hard numbers. Some people will propose the official general average and stuff, but you can see here that the general inflation rate declined. And what do you know? Prices continued to drive higher here, right? Going from around, you know, 25, 30% annualized inflation down to 15% is going to have a pretty dramatic supply cut reduction because you're removing 15% of annualized returns of new supply in the market, right? And then we can see here as well, we went from around a declining inflation rate that dragged down all the way here towards around 9%, down here towards around 4 to 4.5%, right? General halving in the issuance of new supply. But the gap between those ranges is much smaller. In fact, it's half of the decline we saw back here, right? Now, I understand some people say, Nick, well, like you're not getting it. The halving event is a reduction, right? Halving of the inflation rate. Shouldn't it have the same effect? It doesn't exactly, right? And I can go ahead and visualize that very clearly by giving a few visual examples, right? So for example, you can take the, 100% inflation rate we were seeing here, right? And where we are now, around a 2% inflation or 1.7% on the actual numerical value, right? I want to ask you all this. If we created a currency tomorrow, if we created our own fiat currency or our own cryptocurrency, right? And we went from 100% annualized inflation down to 50%, or instead we went from 2% annualized inflation down to 1%, what do you think is going to have a more beneficial element for the price of our asset, right? And just considering those two different dramatic changes, right? They're the same exact amount of rate reduction, right? A 50% reduction in the inflation rate. Which one do you think is going to have a more beneficial outcome? It's going to be the 100 to 50% annualized inflation rate reduction, right? We're cutting it in half, just like 2 to 1%. The problem is the supply introduction of new Bitcoin at the rates we're at right now and where it's going to continue cutting down into with the next preceding halving event and the next preceding ones after that is going to become less and less relevant for the supply and demand that actually drives Bitcoin's price higher. Meaning that we are going to need much bigger demand catalysts to drive Bitcoin's price higher. We are going to basically need much more new buyers in the market than what we have right now. And I think it's a sign of the times of what we've been seeing here in the market. If you take a look at any of the major metrics here for Bitcoin, I can pull it up here actually on the spot. We can take a look here at distribution and look at the number of wallet addresses holding, for example, just 0.1 Bitcoin or more. Take a look at this, right? The vast majority of the growth here coming in over the past couple of years, whereas really we haven't seen much growth here since back in 2020 of new wallet addresses owning more than 0.1 BTC, right? Lots of growth back here over the past couple of years and people who are now owning some portion of Bitcoin. We can even see that here if we take a look at the larger numbers here, right? Those who own more than one Bitcoin in a wallet, it's generally flat. Now, I understand some of you are screaming to the roof, Nick, there's people who are on exchanges, this and that, who are holding Bitcoin. And yes, that is true to some degree, but it kind of counters the argument when you talk about the bullishness of Bitcoin going off of exchanges that everyone continuously talks about. It's either got to be in the wallets or it's got to be on the exchanges. My general point here is that you are going to need more demand over time because the halving event is no longer going to be this major benefit on the supply schedule of Bitcoin that helps to reduce supply in the market. Now, what we need to understand here is that why the halving event was so important for Bitcoin's price was due to the fact that the biggest seller on the market is not just Bitcoin whales or people who got in early. The biggest sellers on the market are the miners. They're the ones who mint new Bitcoins. And each and every day, with each new block and the amount of blocks that are created on average in a given day, there's a block every 10 minutes, right? So you got six blocks generally being created every hour. You multiply that by 24, you get your number of generally newly minted Bitcoin each and every day, right? When you start going from 2 to 1% annualized inflation, that reduction of new Bitcoin hitting the market is not so grandiose as going from a 100% annualized inflation rate down to 50%. That is a much more dramatic reduction in the supply schedule for Bitcoin. So again, we can see here, generally speaking, why Bitcoin's price may be going more sideways here over the past couple months is that we haven't seen the real demand catalyst to drive us higher. And it is going to take longer. It is going to take more time and more demand, more specifically, to get us up to these heightened valuations we know Bitcoin can inevitably reach. Now, some of you might be saying at the end of all this, like, okay, that's a fair point, Nick. I get it. Maybe you disagree with this, totally fine as well. Major thing is you're like saying, Nick, why go on about this? Why is this important, right? Maybe the halving event isn't the only thing we use. Well, that's the big problem that I'm seeing in this space. Some of the biggest data science models rely on the halving event. And what they don't factor in for is the demand side of the equation that we need to be considerate of. One of the biggest things we talked about through the past couple months and why many people thought we were crazy in this case for calling for price to not reach these heightened figures by the end of the year is that we need to consider not only supply contractions, but demand improvements. Improvements in demand, growth of demand in the market, demand for more Bitcoins from new investors who are willing to market order and buy those coins. What we've been seeing this past cycle is people trading paper derivatives, futures contracts, perpetual contracts, leverage trading. They're not buying the real genuine stuff. And to make matters worse, the halving event that usually would help to bump up price even more, well, the next one's going to have less and less and less of an effect than the previous ones before. I think this is the reality that people aren't talking about, guys. It's really important. A visualized way to put it, right? So just going back to this tweet again, if you guys still aren't sold on the idea that the halving event is going to have less and less of an effect, right? Generally speaking, we're at around 18.9 million Bitcoin, right? So generally speaking, it's a little bit over 2 million Bitcoin or 2.1 million Bitcoin that are left to be mined, right? If you were to put it in perspective, right? What's going to have a greater sell side event the next 10, 20, 30 years of newly mined Bitcoin or Satoshi, for example, selling his estimated 1 million Bitcoin on the market? Satoshi's Bitcoin, even if he did it on the same progression, it's going to have just as much, if not more, of an effect. And that starts to put things into perspective that, wow, you know, the existing supply of Bitcoin being sold, even a fraction of the existing supply, is going to have way more of a negative effect, or at least holds just as much importance if that is bought and held or sold than the newly mined Bitcoin over the preceding years, right? I hope my point's clear. It's a bit hard to visualize it, but I try to give as many examples as I can to kind of help visualizing and kind of counter this point, right? Or kind of contextualize it. But anyways, I know I've rambled on enough today, guys. I want to hear from down below in the comments what you guys think on this topic. You guys, feel free, if you like this video, drop a like, consider subscribing. And if you agree or disagree, please feel free to share it down below in the comments. It's totally fine. But the key point here that I want to derive is that the vast majority of Bitcoin are out there. It is much more important for us to understand whether or not the existing holders are buying in this case or selling. Are they starting to offload their positions? Are they starting to distribute? Or are they starting to accumulate more? Are we getting new participants in the ecosystem, right? It's a very, very important thing we need to consider. The supply and demand economics of an asset are the most important things for us to understand in order to determine whether or not an asset price is going to appreciate, right? Same goes for housing, same goes for the stock market, gold, silver, all commodities, and even cryptocurrencies. Doesn't matter what label you slap on it, asset markets are practically all the same. So, anyways, guys, that's it for today's video. Thank you all so much for watching. I hope you have a fantastic day wherever you are, and I'll see you all in the next video. Take care, everyone.